Monday and welcome to Collider TV Talk for TV fans. I'm your host, Sinéad DeVries, and this is our weekly show where we bring you the latest news from the world of television, plus talk about the week that was in TV. Joining us this afternoon is Josh Macuga.
Oh, Sinéad, we're here because we feel bad that you're a little bit sick.
It's okay.
But you're not the most important person here today.
Just no, so you know. It's not.
We got Sasha Perl-Raver's birthday!
Woo! You guys, she's finally 21. We've been waiting for this for forever. We can finally take her out for drinks.
And then watch me get crazy.
Yeah.
Dude, somebody out there needs to wife up David Griffin. I walk into the most beautiful bouquet of flowers with a card. I mean, not only is this man a beard to die for, great TV taste, but are you kidding me? Full
that's
beauty queen
so
status.
Nice.
These guys are the best. I love TV Talk.
I didn't do anything, and David Griffin is making me look terrible, worse than usual.
No, because we are a true family.
That.
We are a true family.
We're family.
Was
this is from everybody.
She walked in and hugged David.
Yeah. Exactly. He was like, "You got Sasha flowers," and went for him instead.
David is the best.
I could not celebrate in any better way than with you guys.
David texted me, "Is there anything, like, is Sasha allergic to anything, or is she a vegan?"
And I did a lot of research today. I got up. I saw Sasha's birthday.
I
went on YouTube and I YouTubed her, and I looked at, like, your cooking reel and your interview on Between the Sheets with Macuga, and I was trying to, like, what is she like? And I think I was thinking cupcakes. I wasn't sure if you're a vegan or what kind of cupcake you like. And I said, well, you know, I like flowers. People like flowers, so, you know, I had some
so
flowers.
Sweet.
Why is David Griffin single, you guys?
It's the shock of the year.
You are the best man in the world. My husband looks, like, so stupid right now.
We're going to get into it later. The shock of the year might be one of the Amazon pilots, but the even bigger shock of the year is that David Griffin does not have a girlfriend.
Crazy.
Or a wife.
Insane.
Or
crazy.
Multiple
insane.
Sister wives in Utah.
Yeah. Does that count as an introduction?
Yeah, I'm here.
Yay!
David Griffin!
All right, well, I guess we should just get into it, huh?
Yeah.
All right, Sinéad, what's first?
From a Deadline exclusive, Hulu has ordered Runaways, the fan favorite Marvel drama series from Gossip Girl creators Josh Schwartz and Stephanie Savage, Marvel Television, and ABC Signature. The order is for a pilot plus additional scripts with an eye toward a full season greenlight. Created by Brian K. Vaughan and Adrian Alphona, the Runaways comics feature a group of teenagers who discover that their parents are part of an evil crime organization. Marvel's Runaways will tell the story of six diverse teenagers who can barely stand each other, but who must unite against a common foe, their parents. Josh, is Hulu a better fit for Marvel than ABC?
Well, we're getting, like, ABC's obviously has to stay on board because they are Marvel. Mm-hmm. So I think we talked about it a while back. It was a super bummer that you know, they got rid of Bobby and Lance off of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. to spin off and do that Marvel's Most Wanted that didn't even go. They cancel Agent Carter. You know, they're bringing, not Knight Rider, I was going to call him Knight Rider, Ghost Rider on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. in season 4. So I think that's a pretty cool thing. What I will say is that this series sounds awesome. Mm-hmm. It doesn't exactly sound like a classic Marvel kind mm-hmm. of thing, but, you know, most things that Marvel touches these days is probably going to be amazing, and Hulu has a little bit more leeway. I know Sinéad and I were both big fans of The Path. Did you finish The Path?
I did. I love The Path. Yeah.
I really enjoyed The Path. And they're doing some great original programming. This sounds like almost like a cross, like an 80s kind of a movie, mm-hmm. where the parents are, like, in the KGB and the kids don't know it. There was a movie I was looking up and I couldn't find the movie. I was, like, researching all day, couldn't find it, but it almost has a little bit of the first Red Dawn. Because, like, the kids get together and have to, like, save the world. I hope that it definitely has, like, that dark, almost like a Ray Donovan kind of a feel, but with, like, teen angsty, but not so teen angsty that it becomes, like, a little tropic. Do you
sure.
know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Totally.
Well, so I think the couple questions I have is, one, like, how, if they're going to go dark or go at least to a more adult route, like Daredevil or The Punisher or Jessica Jones, because it is on Hulu, even though ABC Entertainment's developing. Now, that doesn't really mean anything because CBS will develop a show and that may air on, you know, on ABC. They right. do it all the time. It's a big deal, but I want to talk about Brian K. Vaughan.
Yeah.
Is one of the best comic book writers in the business right now. His series Saga is fantastic. Ex Machina. Not to be confused with the movie. Also, another series he did, which one of my favorites is Why the Last Man, which they've been trying to make into a movie
at
series.
FX. It's been
for
at
a long
FX
time.
We talked about.
And don't forget,
yeah.
he's also he himself has written on Lost. He did Under the Dome, and Under the Dome on CBS was all right. But I mean, you know, Brian K. Vaughan's a talented guy, so I'm excited that they're developing one of his series on Hulu. I hope he's involved more too. I hope he gets to write an episode here or there, because he's a very talented writer.
I think he has to. And that's, again, mm-hmm. I mean, yes, anybody who comes from the law school, and I know people have some issues with the finale, whatever, but that, and I have read some of his comics because I was doing some research on Why the Last Man. So interesting. So I feel like they can do some really cool visual stuff with this too. And I do think he will be involved, but I got to go back to the fact that it's Stephanie Savage and Josh Schwartz, because hello, I'm sorry, but the Gossip Girls is...
And Josh Schwartz, the OC.
The OC.
You know, like one of the greatest, I mean, I'll throw myself out there, one of the greatest soap, like primetime soap operas in the history of TV.
He gets teen angst. Yes. He understands how to convey teen angst for an adult audience better than anybody else.
It's like the modern soap opera, and I love that.
Totally. I think that this sounds awesome, fascinating, can play into some of the Stranger Things stuff, can play into like the Goonies-esque kids on the run against the parents stuff. I think, and also the fact that they keep hitting that this is a diverse cast. We're not going to see just like six white folk running through the woods. The other thing that I think is interesting is we really know what to expect from a Netflix branded Marvel show. We don't know what to expect from a Hulu branded Marvel show. And I'm really fascinated to see, this could be a major building block for Hulu as a company and what we expect from their programming. And again, with Brian K. Vaughan, I think, and he'll definitely be involved. There's no way he's not going to be involved. He's too talented on the television and the comic side not to bring him in.
I think, you know, Hulu's, I mean, like I said before, they're just getting into quality original programming. This could be their Daredevil, their, you know, because that's what Netflix did. I mean, Netflix had some obviously great original programming, but I don't think it was really until, obviously, we saw Daredevil and then Jessica Jones that we were like, okay, they're a player, right? In the Marvel, in the comic book kind of community, so... Let's hope this is Hulu. This series is, like, I was like reading, I did all kinds of research. This is like awesome.
It does look awesome. Yeah, totally. Really cool.
All right, what's next, Sinead?
Robert Downey Jr. has been trying to get a Perry Mason reboot off the ground for a while. He first tried to pitch it as a movie with Warner Brothers in 2011, but now, thanks to a Variety exclusive, Downey Jr.'s Perry Mason project has found new life. The actor best known for playing Iron Man will reportedly be producing and starring in the series, with True Detective creator Nick Pizzolatto writing. Nothing's been confirmed yet, and both RDJ and Pizzolatto have yet to comment on their project. It looks like the reboot of Perry Mason could be a go. Sasha, does a Perry Mason reboot with Robert Downey Jr. sound like something that you'd watch?
That sounds so insanely perfect and cool. I mean, I will say the one thing that gives me trepidation is the Pizzolatto involvement, because I feel so burned by True Detective Season 2. But I'm going to put that aside because we don't know that it will move forward with
him. Because we did have True Detective Season 1.
Season 1 was great. We still don't know who was actually responsible for that, but...
But we see what can happen when you rush things.
Yes.
So if you're giving Pizzolatto a little bit of time, like since 2011...
Then maybe he can bang it out. Correct. But this, like, when you think about Perry Mason is one of the longest running characters that's ever existed on television.
30 TV movies.
Come on!
Plus 2 series.
Yeah. You guys are going to have to educate me right now.
Perry Mason is like the American Sherlock Holmes.
So basically, all of the jokes we make about he solved it kind of comes from Perry Mason and Sherlock Holmes. Like, he was he a district attorney or a lawyer?
He was a lawyer.
He was a lawyer.
He was out for justice. Like, that was his thing. Was like, he will get justice no matter what.
And he always could. Like, the way the shows were structured was there would be, like, a court case. Imagine if Night of was one episode instead of 8, and Robert Downey Jr. was the lawyer.
Yeah.
So to see him, because Perry Mason always knew all the angles and could figure out, like, his brain worked so much faster than anybody else's, and that is perfect for Robert Downey Jr., who did play Sherlock, and I enjoyed the first Guy Ritchie movie. I think that it makes a ton of sense for him to play this part, and I think it would be incredibly cool.
And I think what's cool is, you know, he wanted it to be a movie at Warner Bros. He wanted it to be a movie for so long. I mean, this project's been around for a while, that they're going to make it a series, you know, because you can do so much more, and you can give RDJ a little bit of room to breathe, because outside of Iron Man and The Judge, which I thought The Judge was actually a pretty decent movie, he hasn't really done much. Do you know what I mean? Like, Sherlock Holmes, but the second one wasn't really that great.
No.
But those were, like, real quick. Like, they almost seemed like they came and went as soon as they hit the theaters. Like, there wasn't, like, an overwhelming thing. Like, God, we got to get more of these Sherlock Holmes. Like, there would be, like, a James Bond kind of a thing. Do you know what I mean? But
he's making so much money.
I know.
He made, like, $80 million a year ago.
Yeah.
That's why.
He's like,
I'm good. I don't need to work. I'm good. Fine. I'm good. Yeah.
But Perry Mason, this kind of brings, when I was a kid growing up and I would stay with my grandparents, I'd always be like, what's Pap doing? And my grandma would be like, he's watching Perry. You know? Because it was always
on a first name basis.
Yeah, on a first name, because it was always on reruns. Like, every Perry Mason series is on. I guarantee you, if you turn on your TV and you have all the cable package tonight, you will find Perry Mason on a channel. I guarantee it. Whether it's a TV movie or TV series, he's on TV everywhere all the time. Because he's basically like, what's the movie with To Kill a Mockingbird. He was like, you know, he's that big courtroom lawyer that always got it right.
Yeah.
He was one step ahead of everybody. Dave, what do you think?
I think this is perfect because you need a big presence. You need somebody who has that charisma. Robert Downey Jr. has that charisma. Mm-hmm. He is Iron Man, but I'm sure as an actor, even though I'm sure as much money and as that much adoration he gets from playing Iron Man, he'd probably like a new challenge.
Yeah.
This is maybe something he can sink his teeth into. I wonder his commitment, though. Do you think he would just do one season and out? Do you think HBO could get him for two?
No, I think it would be, I'm guessing it would be at least, well, because the thing about Perry Mason is it was so serialized. I wonder if for a new audience, they would have to make it more of like the night of. It would have to be one mystery stretched over 10 episodes or something like that. And then they do a couple of different seasons. But
maybe like a season every 3 years almost, like in between shooting Marvel things or whatever.
Yeah, but the thing is how many more Marvel movies does he have on his contract? Right. Did he have 9 total? Yeah.
So he's almost done.
The Infinity War and then the two, the one that they have entitled.
Turn and sneeze. You got it. Good job.
He's going to be
blooper reel material. Put it in the time code.
Spider-Man Homecoming coming up.
But then he's pretty much done. Mm-hmm. And when I think about Robert Downey Jr., yes, I think of Iron Man, but I think of like Chaplin. I think of so many.
U.S. Marshals?
Kiss, Kiss, Bang, Bang.
Kiss, Kiss, Bang, Marshals.
Oh, boy.
Kiss, Kiss, Bang, Bang. Kiss, Bang, Bang is a great reference for this.
Yes.
I just think this would be, this could easily become one of my favorite shows on television.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Let's go into the superhero rundown, guys. The point in the show where we talk about all the goings on in the superhero world. Sinead, what's first?
In an interview with EW, Andrew Kreisberg, executive producer of The Flash on the CW, offered the possibility that Zoom actor Teddy Sears could return as Black Flash. Kreisberg told the site, "We love working with Teddy. He's such an amazing actor, an amazing person, and was so much a part of the success of this show last season." For those who aren't familiar with Black Flash, in the comics, the character appears as an omen of death to those connected to the Speed Force. That doesn't mean he'll necessarily play the same role in the TV show, but the creators definitely want to keep the character in play. David, would you like to see Black Flash in season 3?
I would love to see Black Flash. I'd love to see more Teddy Sears. Remember when I first saw Teddy Sears on Masters of Sex? I'm like, who is this? You know, this guy's handsome, tall
Dr.
guy.
Langham,
yeah, Dr. Right? Langham, blonde guy, flirt with the nurses. I was like, who is this guy? But he impressed me more and more as the seasons went on. And seeing him here, he's a great job too in The Flash. And also, I want to learn more about the Speed Force. Remember when he was in the Speed Force, there were speed wraiths, kind of like those Dementors from Harry Potter, basically. We saw those were interesting looking creatures. There's a lot of things in the Speed Force, this entity that exists in all life, kind of like the Force in Star Wars. I want to learn more about that. So Black Flash would be a nice window into that. And I really love these guys with Kreisberg, Guggenheim. They do such a good job with The Flash.
I think with the Speed Force and this season with the Flashpoint Paradox is that this whole season, I'm going to need like a little bit of a cliff notes after each episode. Like, where in the time are we? Where in the Speed Force are we? What Earth are we on? Like, there is so much going on. And I'm like, so we're adding another Flash. Okay, cool. Black Flash. Good. He's more of a skull looking guy. Great. I can totally discern him because once they start throwing in all these other Flashes, because now you got Wally West, and you're going to have Jesse Quick, and you're going to have Grant, and you're going to have Barry Allen. You're going to have Black Flash. You're going to have the other Flash on Earth 3, which we're talking about. You have the Flashpoint Paradox, where the dad can be I mean, there's going to be all these other speedsters now. The whole world is just one giant fast person.
They need to do like we were talking about Suicide Squad
Janae,
earlier.
Can we get on Janae's face?
What's going on? What's happening? What's going on? Remember, like when Sinead, you just saw Suicide Squad recently, and you enjoyed
last
it.
Night.
Yeah. So with Suicide Squad, they do those introductions. You know, when Killer Croc would show up or something, they'd be like, dude, and then have like this list of things he did, his alias, his name.
Yeah.
They need to do more of. I think if they did something like that with the different timelines. Like we're in and then have like have a list of what's
every
going
episode.
On. Every episode, like that would be fine.
Like we're on Earth 3, OJ guilty on this planet. You're like, cool.
Because the show Fringe had to deal with some of that.
Yeah.
I love Fringe, right? Fringe is so good, and they did a good job with those different worlds and all that kind of stuff.
Cool. All right, what's next, Sinead?
Wonder Woman star Lynda Carter is coming to Supergirl this season, playing the President of the United States. And Supergirl herself, Melissa Benoist, posted a picture of her and Carter giving fans their first glimpse of DC TV's biggest leading ladies together for the first time. Sasha, does this picture give you the warm and fuzzies?
It totally does. I saw it on Instagram first, and I mean, since it is my birthday and I'm old as dirt, I cannot tell you.
I've seen some dirt lately that is.
You are only 21. They don't need to know anything else.
That is so true. Well, okay, so there was a
period
of time.
You did get carted at Wood Ranch last Thursday.
That is true. So. There was a period of time where every boy in the world had like the biggest boner for Lynda Carter.
Yeah.
And it's so nice to see her
and
back.
Man or dad of two young sons.
Right?
My dad loved Lynda
Carter.
Sorry,
Mrs. Griffin.
Sorry.
But Come on.
Lynda Carter's hot. Yeah.
Lynda Carter
she's still bringing the heat.
She's so looks to good. Have her mm-hmm. on this show, I love it. I love that they're bringing these two like ultra characters, like pillars of the superhero community together. Mm-hmm. I mean, I wonder if like Lynda Carter does have like a secret identity that will be revealed. Mm-hmm. If it is just that she is a straightforward character. But that's one of the things I love about Supergirl. Is the way they'll be like, here's Dean Cain. Like they randomly, like they are so aware that we're aware and they give us these things. And I just think it's like the most delightful treat for fans.
The thing with Supergirl, now that it's on the CW, I'm really excited about it.
I am too.
Yay! Right?
That's why I think I was so disappointed. Yeah. Yeah. That's what I was disappointed with the panel because they didn't show us anything. They hadn't started filming yet. So I wanted to see something. I can't wait to see it. I'm excited. Right.
Yeah. Shasty? What do you think?
I'm excited for it too. I mean,
you were talking about when Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. is over, and then we can talk about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. when the new season starts.
I know, but I need something to binge. I mean, apparently there's 700 episodes of The Flash, so maybe I can start that.
And there's 47 speed series for you to get a little crush
on. Seriously, I'm so excited for this. Yeah. I don't know why. I was never excited. That's so weird, but I was never excited for Supergirl when it's on CBS.
You know, as a person that kind of like sparingly watched season one, like I probably only watched like 8 of the whatever episodes, like kind of in and out, obviously watched The Flash crossover. If you could recommend to the viewers out there, both of you guys, what episodes they would need to watch, or do they need to watch the whole first season, or do you think they'll just jump from a point where it doesn't really matter?
I really like the Martian Manhunter episodes. I wish we had that actor's name, but from Homeland, but he's so good.
I think that you really should start with the pilot, just because I thought it was great and set the tone so well. I love the Flash crossover episode. Damn, that's hard to say. Sinead, say it with your cold.
Flash crossover episode.
Look at her. Nice. She's so good.
Professional.
Flash. Martian Manhunter. What is that dude's name?
John Jones.
Oh,
John Jones.
But don't you think that they know? They must know that they're going to have to at least help set up the story again, because this is an all new audience. Regardless if people are so intrigued by it to go watch what the what CBS put out the first time around. But this is also like a CW audience is so different than a CBS audience.
Well, I wonder if the first episode of this season won't be a huge crossover episode. Like, I wonder if it's going to be one of those like full night of superheroes on the CW, and each episode will lead into the next episode to ensure that they get that built-in audience. Totally. That's what I was wondering. So I don't know if they'll have to do like, we know the origin story. We know the basics. I think, though, that the first episode of the season will probably be something that brings in some outside characters from other CW shows, but also jumpstarts the world. Like, I bet we'll get a really big bat in the first episode that we will probably follow for a lot of the season, because there does need to be more enthusiasm and excitement built around the show.
So one episode I want to point out in particular is called For the Girl Who Has Everything, which is based off a famous Superman comic, and it's where she's basically tempted with her past life.
Oh.
Like, this reality you're in isn't your best life. Like, you need to be back on Krypton. This is what things would be like if your mom and dad were still alive, everybody was still around. This is what your life would be like. And she has to struggle between both worlds. And like, do I stay in this world? Like, you know, mentally, she has, you know, some thing attached to her. And, you know, which one is she going to choose? And that's one of my favorite episodes. That's a really good Superman story, too.
Yeah. So, the Girl Who Has Everything, also Sasha's origin story of today's TV talk.
Yep.
She's got all those followers. There you go. All right, we're going to go into our review of the most recent episode of The Night Of on HBO. Last night's episode, episode 7, the penultimate episode. Apparently next week, the season finale, or the series finale, if you will.
Almost 2 hours.
1 hour and 45 minutes.
Yeah. Thank God.
Because
we have so much ground to cover.
Really do. I don't know where I kind of want to start on this one. I guess I want to start with the opening scene with the mother in the courtroom as she leaves.
Oh.
And that scene with the lawyer in the bathroom, and she like pulls away. This mom, you really got a feel for this mother. I mean, they're selling their wedding rings. They're selling all this stuff. And the mother is really starting to believe that her son did this.
Yeah.
And you can, the actress that plays the mother, she's fantastic.
And has had 7 lines the entire show.
It's all here. I mean, just like, she's just sitting there in the bathroom alone, just still. Like, not shaking, just completely still. Nothing. You just feel what she's going through. I can't even imagine. I mean, because she's like, you know, did I raise a monster?
Yeah.
You know, a monster must have done that. And then let's talk about the name of the episode, Ordinary Death.
Yeah.
You know, in the beginning when we see that murder, I thought maybe they're going to go into that more like, oh, maybe this guy is a serial killer or something.
Yeah.
They're like, nope, just another ordinary, not just another day, you know, in New York or whatever, you know, just kind of whatever. It just happens. But
well,
it's like,
and it's the checklist when Box is checking off what sort of retirement fund he's going to have. So I feel like this episode set me up in a way where I'm like, wait, has Box actually been on his side the entire time? And is he trying to get a mistrial? Is he trying to, because he has been a detective for so long, he knows the ways to make a jury swing in the opposite direction where there is a shadow of a doubt? Because the whole thing with the inhaler, and also with the inhaler's on the bed is covered in blood, the inhaler has no blood on it. Why did no one talk about that on the episode?
Oh, that's interesting.
There was no blood. It was completely clean. So I thought that was really interesting. I loved the guy who played the Katz, Dr. Katz, the like celebrity.
He was on the OJ trial.
That was so incredible. That whole scene was so great, but
that guy had some charm. He was a charming guy.
And he knew all the questions. He's like, I know what you're going to ask me. Like, I know what's coming. Like, I've been here so many times before. Yeah.
This episode, the one scene that had me screaming was the scene where the lawyer and Nas are in the room talking together, and you realize there is like a flirtation happening. Yeah. And she was shot in this way where she was blasted with light, and she almost looked like her eye line was off.
Yeah.
So it's like, is this dream sequence? This is a dream sequence. And then it kept flashing to like the Andrea stuff. I'm like, dream sequence, total dream sequence, total dreams. Please be a dream sequence. And then they kiss, and I started screaming. And then instead of
did you not like it, or did you like it?
I thought it was horrifying. And then instead of cutting out of it, they cut to the CCTV feed of the footage of them kissing. Mm-hmm. So again, I'm thinking mistrial, because a lawyer can't be sucking face with her client. I don't
know. That's not allowed?
I don't know. Well, there's a lot of
things
that
I'm
sure.
I've never really been in trouble, but I would imagine if I did, I would get a hot lawyer so I can try and make out with her. At least makes the most of the situation.
Well, but here's the other thing. How come the murder weapon is not in a bag? Why is it not in an evidence bag?
It's got like a chunk of blood on it. Like, there's actual skin on there.
He's like, hey, can I do a little demonstration on the table here? I can grab this, right? Put my fingerprints on it.
Can you guys juggle knives?
Why is something not in a bag? Put that thing in a bag.
How come no one has got the guy who was working with the hearse?
Huh, David?
I know, right? The guy, the really creepy hearse driver guy. No one's brought him in to talk. Yes. That guy is
Well,
creepy.
I feel like Box had just given up. He was like, I just want to be retired. I just want to be done. Mm-hmm. But he's going to be haunted by this.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if what's going to end up happening is I have so many different theories. Is he going to get, is Nas going to be convicted, and then will Box come back, and will he be exonerated, and it's going to be like a 10-year flash forward? Yeah. Is there going to be a mistrial? Is it going to be, I still think the cat is the key. You know why? Because John Stone's walking through Chinatown, leaving the chiropractor acupuncturist dude, and you see one of those golden good luck pussies. Sorry, Mrs. Griffin. And I was like, it's the cat. The cat is key. The cat is the good luck charm. Something's happening with the cat.
But the sad thing is, and now it's something with the cat.
I think she just wants the cat to happen because she owns a cat and she thinks cats are important.
She does love it. She loves cats. But there is now, the whole thing is that it was reading an article in Vulture, and he's no longer innocent anymore. Nas is—he's guilty. He's part of a murder.
Oh my god!
I mean, he's a murderer. I mean, he didn't murder the guy himself, but he's basically
a
murderer.
They should have called this show "Making a Murderer."
They
made a murderer.
He's a murderer now. No matter, let's say he didn't do it and he gets out, he's still. Now he's a criminal.
He's Sinbad. That moment, I have to say, major props to the actor who got the razor to the throat, because the way he acted that scene was so brilliant.
Right.
It was so real. And Petey, R.I.P. Petey.
Yeah.
That was heartbreaking. Yeah. But this episode,
the casting in this show is
like, I don't even know the mom, but I felt bad for the mom. Like, the mom was worried about her son being in there. Like, you just feel bad for everybody.
And then Trudy Styler just showing up to like play footsie. So here's the thing that I found out yesterday. There was a pilot shot with James Gandolfini.
Yeah.
I want it.
You want to see it?
I want to
see it. I would love to see
it. I will do anything to see it.
After they're done, maybe they put that on HBO like as an extra feature.
Well, I'm thinking
or something,
maybe when they put out like the DVD.
Right. Yeah.
It'll be, because wouldn't you want to see that?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Oh my God.
I will say that. Thank God we're getting an hour and 45 minutes. I've known this for a little while, that a lot of our critic friends got 7 episodes and they didn't get the 8. So everybody is waiting for the finale at the same time. So we've caught up to some of the people that got the screeners, and now we're all going to be sitting on the edge of our seat as this all unfolds.
Yeah.
Maybe let's. I know we've been making predictions this whole time, and then we'll go into our ranking of this episode. But where do you see this ending? Do you think that he gets out of jail, or do you think that we ever find out who did the real killing, or what's your prediction? David, I'll start with you.
I really think that he's going to get out, and I don't think we're going to find out who did it. I think we're going to be left with that doubt. We're going to be left with that ambiguity But, you know, the thing is, he's going to come home to his mom and to his dad, and his mom's going to look at him, and she's going to have that doubt in her eye. Mm. You can see the tattoos. It looks like in the next episode, it looked like he had a new tattoo, something on his neck poking, like a crown or something poking out of his neck. So he's just going to keep getting darker and darker, and there's going to be that ambiguity at the end. I think that's going to be beautiful. I know it's not what people want. People want that answer. We're going to have some ambiguity at the end, though.
I concur. I don't know that he'll get out right away. I think there's a possibility we're going to see a flash forward and, like, an eventual exoneration. But I think that Freddie has been grooming him to take over his business on the outside. And I think, like I said, this show is about how our justice system lacks justice.
Yeah.
And will eventually turn anybody who is in it into a criminal, as we've been saying this whole episode. But I still think the cat is going to play a major part. I think that what will happen, though, is, like, at the end of the show, there will be that, like, empty, vacant. There will not be this moment of, like, we solved it.
No,
it's going to be, there is no real answer, because at the end of this, somebody did die, and everybody who touched this case, their life was changed.
Yeah.
Right.
Man, I always want to see who the killer is. Do you know what I mean? Like the end of Broadchurch, kind of. You should watch Broadchurch. I think you'd really like season one. I think that we're never going to see who the killer is, but there's going to be something that happens in the trial, like one of those big aha moments where the jury has to either be a hung jury or a mistrial or something like that. And just like you said, we're never going to know who did it. And I think the American justice system is the one that's being basically put on trial.
And who is Nas when he gets out? Who is that kid now? The kid that went into the kid that went
Sinbad.
Out?
Or house guest? You put house guest on.
Also,
the greatest Sinbad movie of all time.
Oh, obviously. Sinbad. Question. Why do you think he smiled at the dude who gave the testimony saying he used to sell them drugs?
Because I think he's turning into a gangster.
I think he's going to get him when he gets out. That kid's in trouble. He's going to get cut.
Did you ever see a more doofus-looking guy in the stand? Like, cut to him and just like...
Which is funny because I'm sure we all had Adderall dealers in college. I had friends who sold their Adderall that had prescriptions for it, and they weren't hardened criminals. I mean, but it's like.
I mean, I sold weed in high school. I used to buy a 10 bag and smoke half of it.
This is why your guys' drug knowledge is so.
I was an entrepreneur, you guys. I was an entrepreneur.
All right, so out of five knives that should be in a bag, what do you give this episode?
Five.
Last week gave it a 5.2, but this show is a 5. Everything's a 5 about this show.
This whole episode, he's staring at those golf clubs when he gets them for retirement.
Oh, God.
And all I keep thinking
is... It was a beautiful set
of clubs. Yeah. All I keep thinking is this guy is the lone wolf. Nobody in the precinct likes him or knows him. If you were to... What do you get a guy that retires that really doesn't give a crap about anything? You don't know, so you just get him.
We've never seen his home life. We've only seen him in the car listening to his opera music. So you don't know, what is he doing? Does he have a family? Was he married? Does he have a? I think he said he had kids to somebody once. We don't know that. We don't know much about him.
I honestly kind of like he's been such a weird mystery. But can we talk about the fact that the kitty was in the bed with him? That was so sweet.
And then he woke up like I would wake up.
He couldn't breathe.
I mean, anyway.
The cat is the key.
Here we go. Let's go talk about this week's. Keep that spoiler alert up there, guys. We're going to talk about this week's episode of Mr. Robot.
Oh,
USA's
massive spoilers.
This is so spoiler. If you guys don't want to know the spoilers to Mr. Robot,
five.
I love that image right
now. 4, 3, 2, 1. Shit got so real.
Dude, it
literally real.
I said last week that last week's episode might have been top 10 episodes of TV that I've ever watched.
The last 2 minutes.
The camera work, the direction.
Dude.
The whole thing.
Now, the big uproar, though, on Twitter is about, like, oh, we knew this was coming. We saw this coming. Like, we called
it,
and we did. Now, Sasha.
We thought it was within the insane asylum.
We knew what was coming. We knew it was an institution.
It was an institution. But again, that didn't take away from it being a great episode.
No.
That didn't bother me. I'm like, yeah, we kind of knew it was going to be institution, prison, sure, whatever. This wasn't reality. But I don't think the writer was going for, and he had a great interview, if you can read, with Alan Sepinwall on HitFix. And he had this great interview where he was talking about, he wasn't going for like a, aha, I got you guys. He was just going for what Elliot is perceiving as his reality. Elliot, like, we pulled a fast one on him. if we can be called the audience, has pulled a fast one on him. He pulled a fast one on us. He got back to the audience, but it wasn't supposed to be like this moment that I don't think anybody saw coming.
But I have a question.
Is Elliot in prison?
That's the question.
So you think there might be that's not a reality either.
No. It's, what is he in prison for?
Oh, exactly. Yes. Oh, what is he in prison for?
Was the Ray thing real time, right, and then everything that happened afterward, the DOC stuff?
Right.
Or was the Ray stuff part of like this weird mind thing?
Right, because how did Ray have like a big computer and everything? I know people can get access to stuff in prison, but I'm like, how do you have a computer and all that? Yeah.
My guess is, because that was my big question, I think.
Because why are they talking about Bitcoins? Like Bitcoin seems like a prison thing to kind of use. Do you know what I mean? Like you saw Dope, you know, the movie Dope.
Yeah, that's true.
You know, it's like, and in Night Of, they don't actually use legal tender.
Right.
You know, they're
right.
not using, so there must have been something they were running from a prison site in order to get that website up and running, in order to get those bad people Bitcoin.
So maybe when that cop was like, stay right here, maybe that was,
See, because I actually thought that maybe what we were watching was that was like played out in actual time and everything else was what he was dealing with in his mind, but I don't know. But that's part of the genius of this show.
Bless you,
Sinéad. Bless you, Sinéad. Is that I have no idea. And I also, I have to say, so I kind of talked smack about Dom last week. I will continue to, because I still don't like that girl. But I loved the way Angela dealt with that whole thing. Mm-hmm. And the fact that Dom was like sucking on the lollipop, that stupid damn lollipop. And as she's walking away, she's like, 4th of July, I'm gonna find a barbecue to be miserable at. But there was that one, that fantastic shot of her walking away from like the rest of the guys. And I'm forgetting what was on the screen behind her, but it said like number one in customer satisfaction or something like that.
Yeah.
It was such a brilliant shot. It was such a great scene. And I loved that Angela has become so complex, and what's going on with her now.
Mm-hmm. How about the scene where she's talking to the guy that's the head of E Corp, who also, I wanted to tell you who I remember him from a show, obviously, and he was fantastic most recently anyway. And he's like, would you like to hang out with me on my birthday? And she's like, no. Like,
oh, well, he's like, well, maybe next year. Yeah, maybe next year.
Like, awesome.
I've been there. It was fourth grade. It broke my heart. But Jesus, as an adult man, he's like, I mean, that was stone cold killer stuff right
that
there.
That was awesome. Yeah. And then again with the guy where he was like, he asked me what I should do with you, and he said, whatever I want. I'm like,
holy evil corp.
That guy's a great actor from the Nick.
Yeah, from the Nick.
As soon as I love him. Yeah.
He's one good actor. If you
always plays
watching,
a creep. If you watch the Nick, he's always a creep.
The creepiest of the creep in the Nick.
He was great though.
He is. Oh,
awesome.
Mm-hmm. Huffing.
Yeah. Just what I guess maybe my last question before we go into rankings of this is, now what?
Yeah.
Now what? It almost feels like, you know, so if he's in prison for whatever, we don't know his length of term. How is this all now playing out? Where is the sister? You know what I mean? Like, what are we seeing?
Well, because the sister said that, you know, oh, this is good for you. Like, kind of talking about this place, like you being here. I mean, granted, we thought he was at his mom's house, but he's actually in this prison.
Never
so,
talked,
and then Ellie said, no, this is good for me. So it's like, it's almost like he's accepting it, and she's kind of accepted it in a way. She seems shocked by it.
Right.
So you wonder what's going on there. Yeah, I have no idea. That's a good question.
Well, I like that she's out and kind of on her own and doing her own. Mm-hmm. Well, my biggest, like, wait, what is going on moment was, so it was that, and where in the timeline that happened. But also, they were looking at something. F Society was looking at something on a computer, and they said, and this is happening tonight. And they didn't show us what that thing that was happening tonight was. So I'm wondering, are we in a situation where all the characters that we care about are about to go to prison? Because Angela is now being very closely watched, and she is totally suspect.
Yeah.
We know that he's behind bars. We know that Darlene is, I mean, what is she about to get herself wrapped up into? Mm-hmm. Could she be going into a trap? Is this something that like the FBI is like laying in wait? I just thought it was such a great episode. I loved the reveal. I loved the way they handled it. I loved the camera work. I just thought it was genius.
I'm with you. All right, so out of five, well, I mean, we had a good one this week. Dom was the one.
Oh,
who did
yeah.
It was good.
Yeah.
I think this, I mean, if I said last week was a 5 out of 5, this is like a 5.5 out of 5.
You can't go above 5. It's
fine. Like a hard 5. This has been my favorite episode of the series, without a doubt.
But you said that last week.
I know, but this one came along. This was in, come on, you can't tell me that the art direction and the directing.
This was
and
good.
The
I don't think it was as good as last week's, though. Or, sorry, well,
I mean,
the week before,
there
I guess.
Was
the
Full House.
The Full House
no
episode.
Alf.
There was no Alf, that's true.
When we put Alf in an episode.
Oh,
that's,
also, how about like him having the conversation with his dad about what they actually did or did not do, and they did do?
So, could he be in jail for the killing of.
I don't think so. Okay. But maybe, though, he could. What do you think? We don't know.
What do you think the guy was shot up with? The one of the hackers, Darlene's Cisco? Boyfriend. Yeah, what was he?
So the Chinese, when the Chinese guys were torturing them. I read one of the writers say that there was that horrible moment where they like give him the whatever those, I don't know, the hacker thingy.
Yeah.
And they stick a needle in his finger and then they break it off. It was just to torture him.
Just to torture. That's it.
Because
okay.
I thought that too. Like, is there injecting something?
Yeah.
Is there
right,
a thing
yeah.
in it?
That's what they used to do in World War II.
That's right. Why? Yeah. The fingernail stuff.
It's
yeah.
I one time when I worked at a bar was rubbing was wiping the wells at the end of the night, and I wiped through and a toothpick went straight to my cuticle.
No.
Went straight under my thing. No. I've never been in that much pain before in my life. I immediately threw up because I was in so much pain.
Oh, Daredevil, they did that. Remember they tortured him, they put the wooden sticks like in his finger. Yeah, yeah, that's right.
The bamboo
that.
And they would
bamboo. That's right.
And they would rip out the fingernails. There's no more bigger pain.
They did that in Lost. Didn't Saeed do that in Lost? Remember that? He did the bamboo. Yeah.
Dude, see, I'm not a squeamish person. Like I can handle blood, I can handle poop, I can handle a lot of stuff.
Fingernails.
That's pretty hard.
Yeah, fingernails
are
right.
That's pretty hardcore. That's pretty hardcore.
Okay, so out of five.
Five, I give it five.
I guess like a 4.7.
Oh, yeah. Wow. Okay.
I really liked it, but I like last week's more. I think last week I gave like a 4.9 or something.
Oh, last week I gave a solid five.
Okay.
Maybe I give it five.
We're going to keep this train rolling, guys. So this past week, this Friday, Amazon did
this
their...
photo behind you, by the way, is
it's
unbelievable.
So good. Yeah,
wait,
it's
go
great.
Back to Josh's. That is the best. Josh, make the face. Make the face. Make that face. A little wider. Don't laugh. Make that a little wider. Perfect.
Okay. So Amazon on Friday released three comedy pilots, three half-hour comedy pilots for us, the viewer, to vote on. And hey, Elliot.
I know. Stick your finger in his nose. Stick your finger in his nose. Go up. Yeah, go.
Okay. So we got pilots of The Tick with Peter Serafinowicz. We got Jean-Claude Van Johnson. And we have I Love Dick. There you go.
The longest pause between that one.
There you go. So let's start with The Tick. Let's go through, and then when we're done talking about all three, I'm going to say who gets your vote.
Oh,
obviously.
Oh, I love this,
there you go.
Josh.
Who gets
I
your
actually
vote?
Did vote, by the way. I did go on Amazon and vote.
And Shanasty, you watched all three too, right?
I sure did.
Oh, Shanasty, feeling
it. Let's
start with Sinéad. Okay, Sinéad, thoughts on The Tick?
I liked it.
Okay.
I thought it was funnier than I expected.
Ooh, good.
Based on the trailer.
Have you ever watched the original?
I have not.
Okay.
So I had zero knowledge of The Tick. My biggest complaint about this whole show, honestly, was his outfit.
Oh, you hated The Tick outfit?
I don't like his Tick outfit, but I'm actually kind
of... You didn't
of
like how his little Tick things moved?
His feelers?
Bit?
No, yeah. It gave me the creepers. but aside from that, like... It's fine. Like, if you think about it, if I really thought about it, like, his costume sucks, but, like, he's a tick.
Yeah.
Like, what would you expect? You wouldn't expect a tick to look cool.
Right.
You kind of expect him to look like a giant jabroni, right? Yeah. So,
a jabroni?
I don't know.
That's what The Rock always used to say that. Yeah, jabroni.
Jabroni.
You never heard of jabronis?
But actually, like, surprisingly enough, for a pilot, I usually hate pilots, honestly. Yeah. But I actually cared about our main character
there
enough and kind of was a little bit invested in his mindset.
D. Griff, thoughts?
I really enjoy it. This is my favorite. I love Serafinowicz. I like he's really great in Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah.
He plays a good villain. He has good comedy.
I am the tick.
You know, it's great comedy delivery. I like the look of it. The action sequences were fun. I'm glad this is on a network like Amazon. I'm sure this will get picked up. I would imagine it will.
Mm-hmm.
I like that it's only 30 minutes.
Yep.
It's only a half hour. I think maybe an hour of this might be too much to digest. So I'm glad
way
we said 30
much.
Minutes. Again, I don't think any of these pilots that we're going to talk about here were perfect. But this one felt like the one that's the most ready to go.
Yeah.
Like, this is like, this could, like, if this
it's
came out with
solid.
10 episodes, I'd be like, this is, I don't know, Sasha's giving me a,
I
she had like, she had this, like, every time we had that
agree.
Head, you know, little head tilt, like, I'm like, uh-oh.
Yeah, I don't agree with that, but we'll get there
okay.
in a second.
I like this one.
So, for me, The Tick, I have watched the animated series, and I felt the way I do, like...
You miss Putty?
I do miss Putty, for sure. But if you did like a live action version of The Simpsons, you'd be like, that's weird. And that was how I felt about this. Like,
interesting.
The like pure weirdness that you can get across in like an American Dad or in a Simpsons or in like a lot of film or animated stuff. just when you're filming it with live action, it just can't ever be as weird as it can if you do it in a cartoon format. And that was what I was missing in this. Mm-hmm. I thought this was fine. If I never watched the animated series, I would give this like a B. But because I have watched the animated series, I give it like a B minus. Because I was a little let down. And if this were to go to series, I would not be clamoring for it. I wouldn't be like, oh my God, you guys, it's Tuesday, it's time for the tick. I don't think I would care. Yeah. But I would use that tone of voice.
One other thing I want to point out is that he seems like light years ahead than all of his co-stars.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He just seems like he's kind of like got it. Yeah. Like he's funny and entertaining. And I don't know if it's just like the way
there were a lot of people in that show, one that I've never recognized or ever even seen before. And it did seem like he was like acting his like
butt
he was
off. Yeah, he was correct. Like really going for it. And I wasn't sure if that they did that anybody on purpose else. Or if anyone else, but they're going to have to match his level.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I dug it. I will say, I really enjoyed the tick. I thought Sarah Fenowitz killed it the whole weekend. I was kind of just going around like, I am the tick. Like, yeah, I'm the tick.
Poor man.
So, yeah. But, you know, it definitely did feel B-ish to me.
Yeah.
You know, like, it definitely just had like a B quality.
Yeah.
And I thought we'd get a little bit more. To be honest with you, I thought it would just be a little bit more. I thought the story was kind of cool. It just sort of ended. It didn't really have a real great cliffhanger. Like I was super excited to see the next episode. So I was like, well, we could just get a tick movie maybe, and that would be a lot of fun. Because I did love the animated series, and you know, if you've never seen the animated series, go check it out. But you know, I think I'm with you, Sasha. It was fun. It was fine. It wasn't blowing the doors off the place.
Yeah.
So let's go on to the second one, which is a real just a. Tug a heartstrings for me. Jean-Claude Van Johnson. Can I start with this one?
Sure.
10. I'm giving this a 10. This Dude. Was my friggin' favorite by far.
Perfect.
This is
perfect.
An A. Okay, listen.
Perfect.
I grew up as a kid. I think Mark Ellis texted, like, posted our text on Instagram. I just texted him, you have to watch Jean-Claude Van Johnson. It's amazing because I grew up on Lionheart, Bloodsport, Universal Soldier.
Time Cop.
The
Time Cop jokes.
Sudden Death takes place in Pittsburgh. He plays a fireman / cop that saves the world during a hockey game. Time Cop, Double Impact, Hard Target.
Are you just going to name Jean-Claude Van Damme movies for the rest of it?
Yes. Okay, here's the best quote in the history of Jean-Claude Van Damme movies. Why is your name Chance? Because my mama took one. Like, come on. It's so good. Cyborg is an awful movie.
It's another name. Keep going.
Okay. But he was such a huge star, and everybody was thought like, oh, Van Damme's kind of like this douche, and he's kind of creepy around chicks, which he does seem to in this movie, in this show a little bit. He's a little creepy with that girl. But he plays, makes so much fun of himself in this show that you're like, wow, he has a sense of humor. He's taken to the next level of, you know, everything says JCVD on it, everything in this world. And it was really, really funny.
Yeah.
Where the point when he's fighting the real people, like, no, one of the time.
Yeah,
that
was I get confused.
Oh man.
Oh my God.
10 out of 10. Jean-Claude Van Johnson.
So
greenlight it.
Genius. Are you kidding me? The moment that he goes to the pop-up restaurant that's the dry ramen shop.
Yes.
I was like,
yeah.
And
that
so
was
it's,
hilarious.
It's homeboy who did Keanu and worked on Key and Peele, Peter Atencio. He's so smart and so funny when he's with Felicia Rashad, his agent, having this whole meeting, and they're taking all of these like
Channing
properties
Tatum's.
With the Channing
it's
Tatum.
It's all Paramount too, which
oh
is always
God.
Fun. At
I was
Paramount,
crying.
At Paramount.
I was crying, and then also knowing that Ben-Hur came out, I was like, it's basically, they made the Ben-Hur joke.
Yeah.
It's so, so well done. This show, I would, if there were 12 episodes out right now, I would binge every one. That would be my birthday present to myself.
Yep.
This show is perfect.
This is what I'm like, when people say, what should we do in TV?
This is the idea.
If go outside show, the box.
If this show, so I did vote in all of the Amazon pilots. And one of the questions is, and I voted for this like a mofo. Would this show become one of your favorites? I was like, absolutely without a question. Does this show exist anywhere else? Or does this push television forward? I'm like, pushes it forward. Do you feel like TV, like would Amazon have more value for you if this show existed? I'm like, 10, 10.
Sinead, 10.
This show is a Sinead.
This show is a Sinead.
It's a 10.
David Griffin, David, not on
he's
board.
He's like, I didn't like it.
I don't know. I mean, okay, so I liked up until the dry ramen pop-up restaurant.
That was the best.
That was great.
It's a pop-up experience. I don't have access to water.
And we don't have water.
That's so LA.
The intro was funny with the girl all the memorabilia and all the logos that he had everywhere. But once he got on set and they had like the whole, like I got what they're going for. But I just didn't do it. I was like,
he's a farmer? Come on.
Oh, my God. It was so good. And then he put the hat on. Sold.
And I love him, too.
Forgot about Nowhere to Run.
Yeah, I don't know. Something about it.
If Josh missed a Jean-Claude Van Damme movie, please tweet at him and remind him of the
title. See, I'm like you, like where you were with the tick. I think there's a lot of potential in this show, and I would watch more
Kickboxer?
Of it. Yeah, but I think I'm going to, I'd have to go, oh, yeah. What's this guy's name?
Expendables? Yeah. Expendables 2?
Yeah, it was just, I thought it was just okay. I thought it was solid. I would see more, though. I would watch more. I would give it like you with the tick. I'd give it a B minus.
Sinéad, is this?
Oh my God,
this was not Sinéad? A 10. It was not a 10.
10.
Not a 10.
Is this a Sinéad 10?
What do you say, Sinéad?
This was not a 10.
Bring it up.
I 100% agree with you, David. I think once he got on set, that's when I stopped like being that interested in the story, which was like all the stuff, the lead up to it, the restaurant thing, I thought was genius and like really smart. And I loved all the little quirks that they were making fun of everything. And I wanted to see that the whole time. Like when he got to the set and the fight scene was cool, but the whole conversation with him in the makeup trailer when they were like briefing him, that seemed really cheeseball to me. And it's supposed to be corny, sure, but I don't know. And like the one guy, the Moises, I think his name is in real life, his name is Moises Arias.
The guy who's in Ben Hur. Ben Harper.
He like his whole thing, like his introduction as a character, the girl I didn't really like find myself too interested in.
Yeah, like he's all, like obsessed with her. I'm like, why is he into this girl? I didn't like her. I was like, I'm not into her.
I liked her. And that dress was bomb when she's walking down. I thought it was great. Okay. And I like that dude.
I mean, it was fun. It was funny. It was really funny.
I think maybe it definitely, I will say, and I know that I'm being, you know,
it's obvious. Worth checking out. I would say like if you're go watch it. It just
the nostalgia for me was what really sold it. But also it definitely helped me. If I wasn't such a big Jean-Claude Van Damme guy when I was a kid, I don't think I'd love this as much as I do. But that being said, I still think even if it wasn't him, I still love this 90%.
I was not a huge Jean-Claude Van Damme fan. I like him, but I'm not like, oh, Kickboxer, Time Cop, name 15 more, sudden death. I like him fine. Good splits. I'll take Chuck Norris over JCVD.
The muscles in Brussels.
This was the best.
Yeah, it was really funny.
I loved this. I'm so sad that if it goes forward, we're going to have to wait like 2 years. Yeah. Because Amazon's got the ridiculous schedule of like it'll be a year and a half and then we'll have 4 episodes. Then I'll have to wait.
Okay, let's go to the final one. It's called I Love Dick. And that's the second time I've said that.
Happy birthday to me.
This show was the worst television show I've ever watched in the history of TV. I think this show makes Vinyl look like The Sopranos.
Right, can we leave Vinyl out of this? There's no need for that. Let Vinyl rest in peace.
Sorry,
Mr. Griffin. I love Catherine Hahn. I really, really like Kevin Bacon in most everything he does. The Bacon. This show, I can't tell you how much I disliked this show.
Set it up though, because make sure it's like it's Jill Soloway.
Yeah. It's transparent. It's so indie. Well, no,
she's Amazon's David Milch.
She is. Yeah. So Jill Soloway, because Josh Macuga has gone off the rails because he hated the show so much.
He can't say
I love dick one more time without just losing his damn mind. Yes, spit it out. Yes. Yay me. So Jill Soloway executive produced this. This is from one of the writers from Transparent, and it's a story about Griffin Dunn, who, dear God, he shows his ass in the thing, and I am sorry, Mrs. Griffin, I am sorry, my eyes, I am sorry for the world, because that is something I never needed to see. Catherine Hahn is his wife. They are extremely narcissistic, self-involved, navel-gazing assholes from New York. He's supposed to go to Marfa, Texas to go to a writing retreat. Could you have more white people problems? She's supposed to go to the Venice Film Festival, but there's a klezmer band that won't release the rights for her movie, and she ends up stuck there, and Kevin Bacon is sort of this like cult figure who leads the writing retreat, but also his name is Dick, and everybody loves him.
Oh, Dick's fellows.
Dick.
And he embraces the Dick. He's not Richard. He's Dick.
And that joke is basically the whole show. Like, the idea that you could say, like, I love Dick, and that's hilarious.
Show made absolutely no sense.
For people who dislike girls because they feel like it's too self-involved, it makes that look like Jackass.
No, it makes girls look like they're in philanthropy.
Oh.
Like, this show is
assholes. They're assholes. assholes. The writing is horrible. What did you think? The plot is non-existent.
There's not a plot.
It was garbage.
It was so bad.
I hated it. I kept like wanting to turn it off and not being able to because I knew I had to actually, like, if I'm going to trash something, I have to know what I'm trashing. This was pain. I had earphones on and I was pacing in my living room. My husband was like, what is going on with you? I'm like, I want to throw my computer. I hated it. David? You loved it. White escapism. White escapism.
This is a little too much white escapism for me. God. Even for me. Even I have my... No, this wasn't awful, but it was my least favorite out of all the pilots that we watched. I love Catherine Hahn. I saw Bad Moms this summer. I mean, she's so funny.
She good crushes in Bad Moms. Yeah. She's the nicest person I've ever done a junket with in all
and
of
it's, this is one of those shows I want to root for because I like Kevin Bacon. I like the cast. I like even the way it shot. It looked good. It's just the story. Yeah, like I said, maybe it was a little too self-involved. It's a little too much like, whoa, our problems are so bad. But I'm like, your problems really aren't that bad. Especially after you watch something like Mr. Robot or The Night Of. Like, that's problems.
Yeah.
That's real people problems.
Have you swallowed an 8-ball today? If not. Right. Yeah. I don't want to hear about it.
Yeah.
But I do. I have a little bit of a cowboy romanticism going on right now. We're going to talk about the show Fearless on Netflix. I saw Hell or High Water with Chris Pine, which is really good. Yeah. So, like, seeing Kevin Bacon overlooking his ranch and getting naked and going into the pool, I'm like, that's like a pretty good life.
That was a beautiful shot. That was a beautiful shot. And I do love A Little Wild Things, Kevin Bacon, Return to the Butt.
He's aged well.
He has. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I like him.
All right, Sinéad.
I liked it. it was also my least favorite out of the three, but I think that saying it's like painful is a little extreme.
Interesting.
I will agree that the plot was non-existent, but I liked the acting a lot, and I actually kind of liked the vibe. And I, for someone who doesn't really like slow TV, and it was more on the slower side, but I thought it was really well shot too. Like I thought it was really pretty, and like there was thought that went into the cinematography, which I appreciated. And I love Catherine Hahn, and I love Kevin Bacon. And I also really enjoyed when she was writing her
notes to Dick.
Yeah, and she read them out loud to her husband, and he thought that she was like talking.
Turned
about
him on.
And he kind of took that as like, oh, now he was all turned on, which is like the one thing that they seem to be like missing in their relationship. So I think that kind of like set up a storyline where he's like, he more than anything is so self-involved that he still thinks that his shit doesn't stink, even though she does not care about her husband at all, which I thought was a good setup for the rest of the series if it were to continue. Mm.
I feel like I'm listening to Sinéad talk about it the way I was watching that scene. I was just like...
Yeah, I mean, the scene was gross. And I was watching with my 14-year-old little brother.
Oh,
dude.
No!
Ew!
No! Okay,
we have a lot to get to still on the show. So let's everybody put in their vote for what they would vote for in the Amazon pilots. Sinéad.
I'm going to go The Tick.
David.
I'm going with The Tick as well.
I'm going Jean-Claude Van Johnson.
So am I.
Yes. All right, we're split down the middle, but I still love you guys regardless. Happy birthday, Sasha.
Thanks.
Okay. Before we go into highs and lows, guys, I just want to do a quick shout out to a TV legend that passed away last week, Jack Riley. I was kind of raised a little bit. My parents, there he is on the Newhart Show. My parents, you know, we would watch old reruns, the Newhart Show, and he would stop in. Bob Newhart, an unbelievably talented comedian, kind of brought Jack Riley onto the screen. And he's had one of those careers where you look at his career and he's been in like every show ever. And he was Stu Pickles on Rugrats. Really amazing career, an amazing guy, one of those kind of people that you'd see like, I know him from something, what's he been in? Prayers, thoughts and prayers out to Jack Riley's family, and thank you for all that you did for television. Let's go into highs and lows. We got to do this quick because we still have Twitter questions to get to and David's picks. So, Sinéad, let's go.
Jon Stewart on The Nightly Show.
Hi. I miss Jon Stewart so much.
I was just about to sneeze. I think it's going around.
Put him in the third sneeze of the show. Man.
Hi, he's doing like some animated show on this animated show on HBO he's going to do too. He's got some new projects coming out.
I know.
It's crazy.
Jon Stewart can do no wrong. Yeah, I love him even in Playing by Heart.
Agreed. Sinéad.
Westworld set photos.
Again, I'm still like so mid.
What?
On this show.
Anytime there's a photo of Tandy Newton, you give that a thumbs up.
That looked,
I don't care what you're doing. Tandy. Tandy Newton.
Okay.
Love her.
Sinéad, what's next?
The new Netflix series, Fearless.
Dude, you put that on there last night. last night I was like, oh, what's this? I'm already two episodes in. I love it.
All right, so thumbs up real quick. It is a show about rodeo, yeah. about bull riders. Bull riders.
Oh, this is your
But what's crazy, though, is you think it would be like white escapism about, you know, white people from the South riding bulls. It's about Brazilians yeah. and how Brazilians like UFC, like for, in football, they're yeah. taking over it. Like they yeah. are the best bull riders. It's all Brazilians.
Yeah.
It's so cool.
Wow. Hi. I yeah. didn't watch it, but now it's I good. Will.
Sinead, here we go.
The Varsity Blues series at CMT.
It's a team! It's a fucking team! It's a team!
Oh, my God. I can't oh wait. Oh, my God. What? Oh, I cannot wait. And somebody was like, it's CMT. I'm like, that makes perfect sense.
All the world. Where Texas football.
Duh. I can't wait.
Hi.
Oh, I do watch your live.
I'm going to watch it. Hi.
Okay, hi. Sinead, what's next?
Josh's favorite show, Fear the Walking Dead, is back.
Guys, it's mid-season premiere of Fear the Walking Dead last night, and it was terrible, but I'm still watching the show.
Aren't they in Mexico or something?
Yeah, they're in Mexico. Aren't they just followed the one guy.
I thought they were on a boat.
No, the boat was last season.
What was that?
That was my phone. Who cares? It's got a huge case on it. All right,
Sinead, you got to make this super quick.
Okay, well, it's going to be fast because basically all that we really found out, there's a season finale of PLL next week, so all we really found out in last week's episode of Pretty Little Liars is that, yes, Mary Drake really did have another child. We think it was a boy because her doctor, Dr. Cochran, said that he never got to see the sex of the baby. It was taken away so fast, but the baby was wrapped in a blue blanket when he looked at the baby in the nursery. And Spencer is later looking at photo albums, and she's looking at her family because she's trying to figure out what's going on and how this is all connected. And she sees herself wrapped in a blue blanket on the very first page. So she's starting to think that maybe, just maybe, she is Mary Drake's secret child.
Amazing.
And that this is all going to come to a head in the season finale.
Obviously, blue blanket's got to be a misdirect.
Got it. All right, let's do three more.
Okay, the Lost Boys TV series in development at the CW.
I'm going to give that a high.
I think it'll be good.
Yeah, Lost
like
Boys,
post-Vampire
yeah.
Diaries, yeah. but like if they, I think they're going to like try and throw it back to the 80s kind yeah. of thing. I would totally get into that. Sinead?
The Get Down that you continue to watch?
I finished all the episodes mm-hmm. of The Get Down, and I will say this, I was wrong. The pilot was not that good. The pilot ended kind of good, in my opinion, and the show really crescendoed from there. I know we got a lot of hate last week in the comments for The Get Down, but I really enjoyed where this series went. The music was fantastic. The drama, the production value got better. Always trust in Jimmy Smith. Jimmy Smith will never steer you wrong. Get down. You're back in my book.
All right,
I can't wait for
that. That's a relief. That's what we wanted.
Yes.
So I guess we should all watch it again. Okay.
All right. And the last one.
Producers say justice for Barb in season two of Stranger Things.
We still don't have a season two green light from anything from Netflix, but if the producers say they get one, Barb will see
Barb
justice.
Barb deserves justice.
Hi, Barb. Hi.
I love that too, but the fact that we did not bring in Brian Lochte, that is tantics from you fools. Tantics.
What's up with his hair there? Is it like dyed blonde?
He dyed it blonde and then blue and then dyed it back to brown so he could look like he was an upstanding citizen.
Ryan Lochte, let's just all agree, awesome. Ryan Lochte's an idiot. He's out.
Ryan Lochte is a low?
Yeah, low.
Ryan Lochte's
a low.
A high because he's so dumb.
He's the
tantics.
Dumbest.
All right. Tantics on this set.
Let's go into Twitter questions, guys. Always hashtag @ColliderTVTalk. Send them throughout the week. We have a great collection of tweets from you guys, so thank you so much. Sinead, what's first?
Cooper Wilson says, which two characters have the best bromance on TV? For him, it's Sean and Gus from Psych.
Besides Josh and David?
Yeah, there's we golfed yesterday.
Yep.
We played 18 holes together yesterday. Hit a lot of balls. Nothing wrong with that.
I love Dick.
So. I love Dick. Cool. He loves Dick. Cool. We know that.
I'm going to go best bromance on TV right now would definitely have to be, you would say Hodor and Bran.
Oh.
Which is tough.
Oh, hold the door.
But I'm gonna go Woody Harrelson and Matthew McConaughey in True Detective.
I like that
they
one.
They came around. They got a little romantic on it.
What do you think, Dave?
I'm going with Justified with Timothy Oliphant's character and Walton Goggins. Even like they were kind of like, you know, boyhood, you know, their friends growing up, kind of went separate ways. Walton Goggins' character was a criminal. Raylan Givens became a U.S. Marshal, but there's still that like tie that has them since childhood. And it is a bromance, even though they're at each other's throats most of the time throughout the whole series. One of my favorite bromances on television. Check out Justified.
I feel like you guys are leaving the romance out of bromance because the answer for me would be Mr. Burns and Smithers.
Oh, nice.
Because that's Smithers. Where the real romance between bros goes down.
Shanastic.
Excellent.
I would go Corey Matthews, Sean Hunter, Boy Meets World, and then Joey and Chandler. Obviously.
Oh, yeah, of course. Well done. All right, what's next?
Dylan tweets, what is the best single season of TV on Netflix, minus Stranger Things or Daredevil season two?
I'm going to go with my road dogs. I'm going to go season two of Peaky Blinders. Best single season on Netflix, even though
it's technically BBC, in the States, but in the States, it's a Netflix original. That's true. That's a good point.
So,
Ooh, that makes it. Oh, that opened up a whole new world to me. That, oh no, that's. Yeah. Oh wow.
David's going something.
I know.
With it.
I feel like. Yeah. Well, no. Because Stranger Things, I think, is so perfect. But oh man, I mean, I want to say Stranger Things. I think I have to say Stranger Things because really? I feel like that really was a game changer.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And if I were to go, I feel like it's Stranger Things. Like that's okay. Just the answer.
Sinéad?
I'm almost caught up on Stranger Things, and so far it's really up there. And I also agree with Daredevil season 2, but then I also have to include Making a Murderer.
Yeah.
Only because it just was like one of those ones that I could not stop watching.
Legendary. Yeah.
That's hard. I mean, we just watched Last Chance U. Mm-hmm. I mean, that was a documentary, but it was still fantastic. I'm going to go. I said this a few times with that show River. Sasha, you got to watch that detective series.
Yeah,
Papa Skarsgård, Stellan Skarsgård. I think it's 6 episodes. He's a detective. I'll say he has a little bit of a disorder, which you can watch more and discover more. It's so good. It's so well done. I believe it's a BBC series.
Cool.
Yeah, it's very good.
All right, that'll do it for Twitter questions. Guys, thank you for sending in. Hashtag Clatter TV Talk. All right. We're coming to the end of the show here. Time for David's Pick of the Week.
Yes! That was a big one. That was a big one. Thank you for that intro, Josh. We're going to talk about Sundance TV's Rectify. I think if I can give a little spoiler for next week,
man.
We're going to talk about, we're going to do Gamora next week, which is an Italian import.
Correct.
We're going to talk about that. Sundance gets those shows a little bit later, but Rectify is an American show.
It's truly American.
truly American.
Place in the South.
About this act. So imagine the night of. We're all talking about the night of on HBO, and you have young Nas there at the age of, I don't know, he's 18 or 19 years old, let's just say. So imagine if Nas went away and he came back 18 years later, after being convicted, and they discovered some new DNA evidence and said, well, maybe he didn't do it. And he gets to go home. But he's in this small town. He's not in Manhattan. He's in this small, small town, which is this character's name is Daniel Holden.
Yeah.
So he's in his, I guess, mid to upper 30s, comes out, and the small town remembers what he was accused of, this murder that he may or may not have committed. And, he's got some social issues. Being in prison for that long, on death row has messed him up. And he comes back to his loving family. He's from his mom's point of view. He's a loving mom. He has a father-in-law, or no, a stepdad, sorry, stepdad, a stepbrother. He has a sister who also loves him, but he's stuck in the small town.
Yep.
And everything that he has to go through, all this is pain and remembering and forgetting, and did he do it, did he not do it? And it kind of, the show wrestles with that throughout its 3 seasons so far. I believe we're going to get the 4th and final season, which is going to premiere in October on Sundance TV. You can catch up on Netflix right now. It's a very good show, very emotional. Every episode just pulls everything out of you emotionally. You'll want to cry after
it
every
is.
Single. And thankfully, it's only about 8 episodes. Yeah. As they don't push it too far because it wrecks you emotionally.
TV that I've ever
one of the most beautifully shot shows, yeah. Sasha, too. It's gorgeous.
You're selling this thing like nobody's doing.
I've seen every episode. I love
it. Doesn't
this
just kill
show.
You? Like every time. It's hard to, you can binge it, but it's hard to binge because it's just, you need like, hard. You need a minute to step back after each episode.
Yep.
But it's earned. It's not like it's trying to be melodramatic just for the sake of being dramatic. It's everything that does is earned. And Ray McKinnon is a showrunner. He's a very good character actor. I think he's on Deadwood and Sons of Anarchy and some other shows, but he's a writer and he kind of just brought this all together.
It's outstanding. Yeah. Go check out Rectify. Yeah. You'll love it. Maybe even Sinéad, that could be your next binge.
Ooh,
there you go. Mm-hmm. It is intense. All right, guys, that'll do it for us here on Collider TV Talk. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Before we go, where can the good people find you, Sinéad DeVries?
I'm online at Sinéad DeVries and at thatsosinead.com on Mondays hosting Collider TV Talk, on Fridays hosting Collider Movie Talk, and hosting Collider Mailbag over the weekend.
David Griffin.
I'm in a few places. You can find me on Twitter and Instagram at GriffinDE. I also have a vlog now.
Yay!
Doing a little vlog. I have 2 episodes up on YouTube. It's just David Griffin. I realize my name is very generic. I also have the same name as a Cleveland Cavaliers GM. So people have
just change it to Mick Griffin.
People have tweeted at me like with like Cavs things. Like, hey, what about the Cavs? I'm just like, whoa, I wish I had that job. I don't have that job. But just David Griffin. So look for me on YouTube as well.
Yeah. And Sasha Perl-Raver.
You can find me at Sasha Perl-Raver on Instagram and Twitter, and giving David Griffin tons of hugs and kisses because he's the best.
I was trying to take you to prom. I'll see if you come to prom with me.
I will always go to prom with you. I love you. Mondays here with you guys, Thursdays with the Schmoes, and Fridays hosting FX Movie Download on FX.
There you go. Guys, happy birthday to Sasha Perl-Raver.
Thanks,
thank you guys so much for watching. I'm Josh Macuga. You guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Josh Macuga. My YouTube channel, The Josh Macuga Show, here every Monday with these beautiful people, Thursday with the Schmoes, Saturday on Film HQ, on Comic-Con HQ. Thank you guys so much for watching. As always, put down the book, pick up the remote.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.